I am Bill Courtwright with Living Right with Bill Courtwright, and this is the Stress Mastery Podcast, where we take you from the science to the spirituality of stress mastery. Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Stress Mastery Podcast. I am Bill Courtwright, and I'm here with the super millennial, David Barreto. You ready to travel?
I'm ready.
Gonna be cold.
It's going to be really cold. I haven't felt real cold in a long time.
It's going to be special. Mark Mittelstead's going to meet you.
Yeah. You're going to meet Mark? We met Mark.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You met him at the event. Yeah, I forgot. He's a good guy. He's a good guy. This week, our topic is resistance. In today's Health Huddles, we are going to discuss our resistance to health. Now, before we get started, I'd like to address the stress mastery coaching as we've received many emails requiring on the coaching programs. So to clarify, we have two types of coaching. We have shift coaching. This is coaching, the type of coaching you're working with me in a 12, it's done in 12-week intervals. And the purpose is to create a complete shift in consciousness with connection to body, mind, and spirit. Now, the other coaching that we have is the stress mastery wellness coaching, which is also designed to create a complete shift in your life. Now, we address connection of head, heart, and hand. You find your purpose. You execute the higher goal setting we've been talking about, and you enter the steps of stress mastery. But the main focus of this is changing your body and health habits. Anything you want to add?
No, I love it. It puts everything that we were doing in the wellness center, but it adds that missing component. Once you change the mind, the body is just something that follows.
You got a new client today, right?
Yeah, she's awesome.
Very cool. Now, this segues us right into today's topic, our resistance to health. So yesterday, we talked about the culture of the tribe. This culture is programmed within each and every one of us. Now, this health programming we carry was inputted during that tribalization process. This programming dictates your health habits. This programming dictates your health beliefs. Our health beliefs, as all beliefs do, keep us stuck in patterns. That's all our beliefs do. They keep you stuck in a pattern. Now, this programming dictates our overall health. We resist getting healthy because the actions we must take to achieve health goes against our inner belief system about health. Health programs come from our society, culture, and immediate tribe. Do you remember any of your health programs from your family?
Yeah. Start with 3 Oreos first. And then, if you're hungry, keep going. And it was never just stop.
Your mom is the master of portion control, right?
Yeah. There's never no end, but start with this.
Yeah. She's a portion control monster. So tribal societies have different programs of health. The first programs of health are these, looking at diet, they are very specific in detail. So I actually had the best education ever on health and wellness. And this education did not come from school. First, my education came from my own health issues. Understanding and mastering my body was important for me to understand health. Second, my education in medicine and testing, and this changed my belief system about diet and exercise when I lost weight. And I believe that if it worked for me, it should work for everyone. I believed I knew the right diet and exercise. Wrong. Testing proved to me there was no one diet. And I'm actually going to go over a little bit of my history in this episode. I'll give you my history and my travels. But testing did change my entire belief systems of diet and exercise. Now, third part of my education was to step into creating wellness for different societies and cultures. Panama and Costa Rica were very different from Peru. Peru was different than the Philippines. Beliefs are powerful and they make up our identity. And the health beliefs in Panama was about eating high starch, especially this food called yuca. You know what yuca is?
Yeah,
you do. You're Puerto Rican. All right, so this is a root, right, that spikes insulin. And to tell a Panamanian now that yuca was bad was like I kicked him in the knee or something. You know, I kicked him and ran. It was bad. Now, the beliefs of Peru was that every meal had a double starch. So they had potatoes and rice. The land of potatoes served as an issue. As I explained, you have diabetes, no more potatoes. Oh boy, that went over well.
I learned that when I was dating a Peruvian. Remember yes. that? I was like, I had potatoes and pasta last night on a cheat night.
They
always, and they have that every day of the week. It was wild.
Now, Philippines, it was rice. Very heavy. And here the Filipinos were tiny little people. But the number one disease in the Philippines at the time when I was there was diabetes. And again, I was met with resistance. So your health habits are deeply rooted in your culture. They're deeply rooted in your society. So if you look at religions dictate what you can or cannot eat. Some religions must have food blessed. Some remove entire categories of food. And some dictate fasting and not eating any food. But they're all beliefs. Now, I've seen people whose health is being destroyed by their current diet. But in order for them to repair their health, they would have to consume a diet against their cultural beliefs. They'd rather die than change. And man, I don't tell you how many. I would sit with the patient and I would say, look at your blood work. This is it. I need you to eat this. I won't eat it. And they got sicker. They really did get sicker. So habits of how we eat are also dictated by society. You know, so Americans look to get as much food as they can for their dollar, right? They want the best deal. Supersize me is the American mantra. You know, Google and look at the original size of the typical McDonald's meal in the company's early days of the 50s. And then look at the size of today's meals. You have to do it. I know. I see you pull out a phone. It's amazing when you see that.
All the time I pull out a phone. Yes.
Now, the Panamanians, I actually picked up some good habits. They love to open the meal with a soup. They don't start a meal without a soup. And then they have their salad and then the main course. And I still maintain that habit today. You see me. I got to have my soup first. Now, Europeans, they eat very small portions. When Americans travel abroad, the health programs shun the size of the meal, man. They really get crazy. I always hear them complaining, this meal's a ripoff. I'm still hungry. All I do is kind of watch them come in and listen. The American culture also has the habit of eating very fast. Eating on the run, eating while working. Other cultures treat the meal as sacred and slow down. I think the Panamanians just wanted more lunch break. But they told me that they have to slow down and eat.
There will be a link in the bio to a very cool video about this McDonald's thing.
It's true, right? Am I right?
Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
That's what I said. So now, our health habits are strongly influenced by our immediate tribe. So we talk culture, we talk society. My mom was always dieting and exercising, going up and down the diet roller coaster. One moment she was eating piles of pasta and desserts, sitting around complaining about how fat she was. The next she was exercising in front of the TV to Jack LaLanne and eating carrot sticks. I remember it, I was a little kid. My grandparents, who I ended up living with, were opposites. Grandfather golfed and exercised. Grandmother cooked and ate. That was it. Grandma had desserts and she was a baker. It was amazing. So your resistance to health is programmed deep within your tribal programming. And that programming is stasis. It's homeostatic to set up for life unless you choose to change it. Now, the diet and self-improvement industry is worth billions of dollars. This industry is built on knowing your programming. So, for instance, gym memberships at this time of the year will oversell their memberships by over 400%, knowing that you won't show up or you'll quit. I already saw the thinning out today. I was shocked. It's only 2 weeks. And that morning, you know, when I'm leaving, everybody's kind of coming in at 5:36, right? Well, not today.
The nighttime crew is getting a little thin, too.
Yeah. It's right?
Yeah.
That's in 2 weeks. That's amazing how that happens. Now, your programming will make sure that after a couple of weeks, and this is normal in January, the gym will not be overcrowded. Right? Am I right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So our resistance to health stems from our hatred of discomfort. That's the way I'm going to put it. That is where our resistance comes from. Our attempts to change our diet are met by the discomfort of resistance. You start out the new year inspired. You go to the gym. You cut out the junk food. And this sets off an explosion within. The body is programmed to deal with stress. So when you have overwhelm, you have anxiety, and you feel this pent-up stress energy, the body has programs to relieve it, much like a tea kettle sitting on a stove. It's boiling and boiling, and it has to leave. Now, this program of managing stress is built upon changing the chemistry of our inner body and our brain. And again, this is survival. So the stress response is driven or managed by diet. And when we are stressed, we look for an outlet for relief. So stress relief. Number one, high sugar foods. Eat a handful of jelly beans and you will release stress. Number two, high reward distractions. Jump on your video game and you will release stress. Number three, change the brain chemistry. Light up, take a puff of that cigarette, a nice big puff, and you just let it out and you will release stress. Consume a drug that allows the body, thus the nervous system, to relax. You release stress. Yelling, shouting, stomping your feet up and down also will release stress. Gossiping, jumping on your social media, this anything that distracts you will release stress, and a glass of wine or two also is pretty good at it too. So you're seeing that these are habits. So if you want to change your life, you want to get into personal development, you want to get into health, you better find another outlet to release the stress. Our cultural programming is powerful. And our health programs are built off, and I'm going to talk about this week, our belief systems. And not just the belief systems of what your tribe gave you, but our belief systems about diet and exercise. They can sabotage our attempts to become healthy. Ask yourself this question, David. Number one, the best diet is?
Do you want me to answer it?
You know it, right?
The right one for me?
Yes. The best exercise is?
The one that I can recover from.
Yes. The best vitamins and supplements are?
The ones I need.
And see, this is it. The answer. The diet, exercise, and supplement regimen, as David said, is the one that works for you. So our resistance to diet and exercise comes from our beliefs about diet and exercise. If you are ever to take charge of your health and overcome the deep habits and the resistance programming to health, you must learn the truth about diet and exercise as it pertains to you, your physiology, and your body. Here is a look at my 3-decade-long journey to discovering the truth about diet. I think I've ever done this before. This will be fun. Number one, and I have a lot of phases. Okay. This is over 35 years, right? So number one, I started my first diet at age 9. I had lived with my grandparents at that time for 2 years and gained a tremendous amount of weight. It was this time I had learned food's powerful stress relief, right? Food's an amazing stress relief, powerful thing, especially sugar. But at this time, I also gotten shingles. So those that are older know that shingles is a stress disease that older people get. You don't get it at 9 unless you have tremendous stress. So my stress was pretty much off the charts at this time of my life. And this would set me on a course of off and on and again dieting that would land me 10 years later tipping the scale toward 300 pounds. I think my max was 278. Now, my beliefs? There was no problem that a good bunk cake couldn't fix.
Oreos. That did it for me.
No, she baked.
Oh, yeah.
Grandma baked. We had real pies. Apple pies, grandma made the apple pie. I told you, grandma baked.
Oh, I would have definitely tipped that 300 over.
You would have went over. But I'm little. You're only 6 foot.
I was going to say, man, I hit the 293. I would have been that 3+.
I'm 5'6". I'm 5'7 on a strong day when I stretch myself, right? So that was the first phase. The next phase would be losing 123 pounds and starting bodybuilding career. In this, my belief systems changed. My belief was eat a lot of protein, keep fat low, eat healthy carbs, consume a lot of calories to get huge. When contest time approached, you cut the fat lower, cut the carbs, live off dry tuna, and you'll get ripped for the show. After the show, you bulked up again. It wasn't unusual for me to gain 40 pounds in the first couple weeks after the show. So my belief system was, gotta be huge. My belief system was, I wanted to be so big when I walked in a room, nobody could understand. And then my belief system was, at this time, for my health, which wasn't healthy, was certain part of the year I was eating, certain part of the year I was dieting. That was my belief system. So that was second phase. Now the third phase was, this was my belief system as I entered family practice medicine, and I had off-season and contest uniforms. So I actually had tailored uniforms, one when I was competing, one when I wasn't competing. It was this time I started to begin to understand lab testing. And up to this point, I studied the body and mind, but never any type of testing. I was getting ready for a show and some guest posing. I was sponsored. I don't even know if they're around anymore. Nutra Power, I think they were called. And the supplements and that. If Shem is listening, or if Terry's listening to this show, he'll know what I'm talking about, because we were sponsored. And I was going around doing guest posing. And I was doing guest posing for the military. Because I was, hey, he's in the Navy. Look at this guy, right? And I was doing some guest posing, and I took my labs when I started dieting. And I thought I was healthy, right? I was big, but I ate well. In my mind, I ate well. I ate beef, chicken, very low fat. I ate sweet potatoes like they're going out of style. I ate salads, no oil, just lemon. I cheated one day a week, and I was doing two-a-day workouts at that time, training the body twice over the week. The bottom line was, my labs were horrible. My labs showed a sick, run-down person. That wasn't what I saw in the mirror, but what I saw on the paper. And as I began to change my diet, I started to run labs every 2 weeks to see what would happen. And I noticed as I got ready for a contest, as the carbs left the diet, and my labs would change along with the carb cutting for the better. Not just the sugar, but all of them changed. All my labs changed. And what happened with that? My belief systems changed. Carbohydrates are bad. That's my belief system now. So that was number four. Number five, I decided to experiment with Atkins type diet. So of all carbohydrates, Atkins got to be it, right? And I began to add fat into the diet while eating protein and eliminating carbs. Again, my labs changed. My cholesterol actually dropped. How could this be? My belief system now was, I knew the right diet. It was Atkins. He's the guy. Right? I want you guys to understand.
That was you. That's the funny part.
Yeah, that's right.
The cookie cutter was you.
Yes. I'm telling you, this is what happens when you think you know, right? So going into the 90s. Now, this is the 80s, right? I'm going into the 90s now. That was after 10 years. How many times my belief system changed in 10 years?
How many times has it changed in the last 30?
Yes. Going into the 90s, I started looking into the glycemic index, and this was pretty amazing. The index ranked foods from 1 to 100 on how rapidly carbohydrates broke into sugar. And this began my fixation on the hormone insulin. And this escalated while working with some patients that had issues like fibromyalgia and pain. In those days, doctors thought that fibromyalgia was a made-up disease. Some still do, that it's not. But these people were in real pain. And then I found, the moment I took sugar out of their diet, the flare-up subsided. And so that made me start looking at the cortisol levels. Mm-hmm. So this is 1990, I'm looking at insulin, cortisol. It was also the time that Barry Sears was working on inflammation and our fat intake and stating that we needed balanced fat consumption in order to manage inflammation. I started learning about omega-3, omega-6 imbalances, and I started to change. And I would end my bodybuilding career here, getting into the best condition of my life. You saw the pictures. That was the best shape of my life. And the thing was, I had struggled so hard for that show because I had dialed this in. Now my belief systems are new. I'm ready to go into the world because my belief systems are now low glycemic carbs are the answer, proteins and healthy fats. And finally, I thought I had it down. I'm the expert. That's what I thought. And this brought me to stage 7. I now had proven that the stress response was not just a stress hormone. I was one of the first in the whole time that the insulin was part of that response. It wasn't just stress hormones. The stress response is a response. And this response always includes sugar, which meant insulin, the other hormone, was part of stress. Now, during this stage, I fixated on the stress response testing. Thousands of patients, all ages and backgrounds. And I learned, if insulin was over 10, you stored fat. even though the reference range just took it up to 23 in those days. If insulin was below 4, you didn't recuperate. You lost muscle. I could see it. So if cortisol was at 15 to 18, optimal, your body ran right. But if it was 10 to 15, insufficient, you'd find yourself getting tired in the afternoon. If it dropped below 10, fatigue happened. And if you had issues, you had flare-ups, so you'd have pain. And below 5, I would see burnout. Now, I found that the only way to manage this response was diet and proper combinations of protein, fats, and carbs. Now, also in this stage, I learned if you missed a meal, which was a snack, the response would also disrupt. So it wasn't just about eating the right things and combinations, it was eating. And I learned that this response was not managed, and this was big for me to learn this, that if the stress response, insulin, cortisol are not managed, all the other hormones will be affected, including your sex hormones and your thyroid. And it was long before I knew what the HPA axis was, long before, I don't even have red zone, green zone yet. This hasn't happened yet, right? So I learned that when the response was managed, the right diet, all these hormones rebalance. Finally, my belief system was set. I know all the answers. So let's go write the book. The Stress Response book comes out 2009, sells 160,000 copies. How's it selling today?
You took it off.
Why?
Because you got to keep changing.
Because the diet's wrong. Those beliefs were wrong too. So number 8, stage 8. I go into a project where we can advance the testing that we've done. We tested all kinds of hormones. We tested leptin, adiponectin, ghrelin. We tested exercise. Remember the exercise testing, right? Mm-hmm. CART tests. We tested vitamins. We tested minerals. We tested genetics. My beliefs after years of putting people on the stress response diet was, man, I had the diet perfect. I want to find out a little bit more about info on supplements and exercise. I had a little bit of an ego.
A little bit.
Yeah, it was a pretty strong one. And so what I found out was, as we did the research and we did the studies, about 85% of the patients were getting incredible results. But for me, 85% wasn't good enough because we were really following these people. And by this time, I had actually advanced out of the glycemic index into what's called the glycemic load, which determines the net carbs, which determines the effect on insulin. So I could easily see the hormones such as adiponectin. This is a hormone that helps the body to absorb carbs into the cells. That hormone would affect carbs, and I was perfecting the diet, but I couldn't seem to get a certain population dialed in. I pored over the data and focused on the genetic marker of the 19th chromosome of our DNA. What is it?
The ApoE.
I contacted the actual scientist who discovered the so-called ApoE4, which is the Alzheimer's gene, and it would take us a few years to get those patients' results. Man, that was hard. You weren't around then. That was the years that Alex and I were doing. And we found that these people could not process pro-inflammatory proteins such as meat, birds, anything like that, or process fats. They could do fish. And so they were right for pescatarian, and they were perfect for vegetarian. Again, my belief system was blown to smithereens. And my new belief system was, I don't know shit about diet, and I never will. And that was my belief system as I come into this. And this brings us to number 9. And this brings the 9th stage of my career in this. And this brings me to the current work that we're doing, right? So now I've changed a little. I don't have any beliefs about it. I know that I got to find the right diet for the person, and that's all that matters. There is nothing right, people. And it took me only 30 years to figure this out, by the way. 30 years and working with tens of thousands of people and testing and, man, I don't know
crap. I got a fast pass, I'll tell you that.
I don't know, but I don't know crap. And so over the last few years, and this is where you and I have been working with Dr. Brian, we found that we could reset the body according to the type of disruption it had. So these are the programs currently. Some resets needed intermittent fasting because of the disruption, why they were not connecting. But we also found that after 6 weeks, this would begin to back off too. So we found intermittent fasting is good for a reset. It's not good for a diet. I haven't seen the results on that yet, so I haven't seen it. I'm just telling you what I see. Now, some resets need to eat every 3 hours, and if they miss a meal, the body would just shut down. And some resets, you have to remove all animal protein to allow the body to heal. Now I've got it down perfectly, right?
No.
Nope. Because the latest research I'm going to share with you is actually validating what I started in 1990. And the latest research, and I mean, I'm talking, this is the latest research coming out. I mean, it's brand new. Is now looking how food affects the body by looking how food affects insulin. In Australia, researchers are testing foods and creating what's called the insulin index. In stress mastery, this is the base of the teachings of the Pause Plan Diet program. We've been talking about, I look at a fasting insulin on every single person. And it's that one test that you must ask your doctor to run. If you can ask him to run that morning cortisol and that fasting insulin, you will see a lot of information on there. Now, this is much different from the glycemic index or glycemic load. They're actually testing food's response on the body, the insulin response. That insulin response, when it jumps, always affects the nervous system and cortisol. If insulin jumps, cortisol jumps, you go into red zone. That's where insulin comes in. Now, they're looking at this insulin index is completely new because they're looking at foods that affect insulin that gives us the information needed to eat the right diet that manages the stress response in the red zone and green zone and our health. Now, they're measuring all types of foods, not just carbohydrates. And this is how what they found so far. I mean, it's really in infant stages. It's only tested about 125 foods. But the testing methods, the science is, you know, I geeked out on it for about 10 hours last night. You're looking at the science behind it because I got the science papers behind it, right? The index goes like this. The index is 0 to 100. Number one, if it's 70 or above, never eat these foods. Jelly beans are a 117. Grape nuts are a 110. A honeydew melon is 93. Garbage. Now, number two, 50 to 69 are very bad foods. You want to avoid these. Raisin bran's a 69. Skim milk's a 60. French fries are a 54. French fries are better than skim milk. And low-fat cottage cheese is a 52. Garbage. Who knew that, right? And 30 to 49. Now, these foods should always be kept to only special occasions. That means you want to keep the portions very small. Special K, 48. Brown rice, 45. Garbage. Red delicious apples, 43. Garbage. Grain bread, 41. You ready? Everybody sit up. Beef steak, 37.
See, this is what kills me. When I was dieting down to like start my whole thing for bodybuilding, I had an apple every morning. I had brown rice twice a day.
Yep.
And I had steak three times a day.
Yes.
To lose weight.
And the testing is showing lean beef steak. So what happens when we eat protein, all protein is broken down to amino acids and taken to the liver, and the liver turns it into sugar, which creates sugar. So, insulin response, right? So beef steak is 37. You know what else is 37? Snickers bar. I mean, a damn Snickers bar. It's also 37. So this, you got to understand, is different. Now, they find if you have a fatty piece of meat, it's better. Fat has little or no responses on there. So fat is go-to. Now, let's look at good foods, go-to foods. These are foods 20 to 29. So basically what you're looking for is 30 and under. Full cream milk, 24. Eggs, 23. Tuna in a can, 26. Certain cheese, 20. Coleslaw is 20. I love my coleslaw,
you
right?
You love your coleslaw.
Yes. So number five, these are great foods. Index, 10 to 19. Chicken fried with a skin is 19. Cream cheese is 18. Roasted chicken without skin is 17. A hot dog, natural hot dog, no sugar, is 16. Tuna and oil is 16. Roasted peanuts. Yeah, you hear what I said? Roasted peanuts, 15. Natural peanut butter, 11. Bacon, 9. White wine. Oh, God, I shouldn't even say it. And 11. Butter, a 2. So you heard what I said. White wine is an 11.
Did you hear the excitement when he said peanut butter?
Yeah, oh, I love it. So now, what are some surprising things that I found? Well, one, sweet potato. Staple, right? Bodybuilder staple. You ready?
Used to eat that 3 times a day.
You ready? 96.
Could add a few snacks.
No, I got more. Cauliflower steamed.
Oh, God.
48. Broccoli steam, a go-to, 29. So why do I present this to you? First of all, that will be the future of this program. I've always been ahead. I was looking at carbs when people were looking at fat. I was looking at glycemic index when they were looking at carbs. I was looking at glycemic load when they were looking at glycemic index. Now, this is the next step. And to me, this is exciting the way they're testing it. How many of you got rattled when I said some of those foods? Did you?
I did. You went down my entire list.
Yes. So this is what I mean. Your beliefs are holding you back. You got to find out how your body works. The numbers I just gave you made Linda crazy. But I go, Linda, you can say whatever you want. These are very strict scientific studies they just did. I saw the protocols. I saw that. This is no joke stuff. And these are clinical trials. They're not telling anybody. There's nobody putting us out there yet. But you can rattle her. What do you mean? So what am I learning? One of the things they're looking at is how you can bring the index number lower by food combinations. So if I have cauliflower and I put the right cheese on it, or I put oil in it, guess what? That it comes down. Mm-hmm. So that's how you learn how to eat. But you're eating specifically for what? What's the purpose of the diet? To manage the nervous system. And you manage the red zone and green zone by managing the stress response, and the insulin kick shoots off the stress response. It all makes sense to me now. Now I finally still don't know anything.
Yeah, I would say the one thing, you know, no matter how many times this changes and the science is getting better and getting better, it's always still what's right for you.
Yes.
Everybody's different.
Now, there's questions, right? Mm-hmm. We don't know, okay, they said you can have white wine. Does that mean what happens if I drink a bottle of white wine? They don't know. That's what I mean. This is very in its infancy.
I know.
Very in. You definitely don't have stress. You don't have stress, right? So I can already hear people out there, now he finally lets me drink wine. Well, I'm just telling you, this is the latest, and the reason I went through that was my belief system changed at least a dozen times over this. And the reason it changed was I kept seeing science, and I got to see more than science. Right now, we actually have test groups, and we're looking at the cheat meal. We're looking at the refeed day. And in some of the refeed days, we're looking at, you take a whole day off, what happens? The other one we're looking at is you just you eat healthy during the day and you take the night off. And then we're looking at if you fast all day and you start at 4 o'clock and eat whatever you want. We're looking at all these things because we got to look. Can't just assume, people. Just because you believe that the paleo diet's the diet doesn't mean it's the diet. I'm telling you guys right now, there is no right diet. The diet must manage the stress response to manage the nervous system. When you understand that, you will be set free. That's what we do in our coaching. We want to go over your blood work. And we want to sit down and show you this is why you need to eat this way. I find that's the way people really understand.
Yeah, I was just telling somebody not too long ago, if you have this belief, bring it to me in paper. Show me the blood work. And if it says, yep, you know what? You're handling it. I can't argue with you.
Yep.
But until then, you know what?
Don't give me your belief.
Don't give me your belief. And tell me what you know. Show me it's working.
And I've learned that I don't know nothing. I really learned. He had to hit me over the head with a hammer. I'd be out there fighting with people. I know. I'm Bill Courtright. Hey, Bill Courtright, you don't know crap. I really learned that. That's it for today's show. Our mission is to create a shift in the planet. You can join us on this mission by simply like, share, and subscribe. The links are right below the show. As always, until next time, stay inspired.